Good evening. I'd like to open the Deerfield Board of Selectmen's meeting for February 10th, 2016. It's now 6:30 exactly at 8 Conway Street in the town in the village of South Deerfield. I see we have somebody sitting at the table, and since I don't, do we have a 6:30 hearing exactly?
Item 4. Yes, I believe it was announced for 6:30.
Okay. We'll move right into the hearing. Which would be item 4 in our booklet. Have you read through the timeline?
These are the notes right here. So we just call it, read that.
Okay. To open this public hearing, it's a notice of public hearing, Board of Selectmen, Town of Deerfield, in accordance with Mass General Law, Chapter 140, Section 157 of the Town of Deerfield's bylaw, Chapter 60, Section 10. The Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on February 10th, 2016, at 6:35, which we're a little early, but that'll be fine. That'll be good enough. In the main meeting room of the Deerfield Town Office Building, 8 Conway Street, South Deerfield, Massachusetts, on a complaint of a dangerous dog housed at 5 Beaver Drive. Parties are directed to of interest are invited to attend the hearing. I have this here, I assume.
Yeah.
Would you please state your names for?
I'm Nancy Sunflower.
Nancy Sunflower.
Colleen George, Animal Control.
Thank you.
I'm
Valerie. Valerie is the owner of the dog at 5 Beaver Drive.
Yeah.
I believe.
Yes.
If memory serves.
Yes. I'm figuring where we're going to place them with a microphone.
anywhere they like. Or Colleen can go in the middle or whatever you'd like.
Why don't you join us up here?
Okay.
Not you.
It's just me. I'm not going to make you 4 times as quickly.
Thank you.
I can help you out.
I don't want to.
Explain. We don't do very many of these, so it's a little helter-skelter. If you could pull that mic just a little bit closer to you.
Oh.
They have one there that would be between. Because it would be hard for people to hear. We've complied with this chapter 60 of it. We have a timeline that basically is, I think, have you seen the timelines?
No.
This isn't really something that got put out there to the public, but I've got a copy
here. Since they are the plaintiffs, I'd like to make sure that they... And I have another one in here, don't I? I want to make sure that the timelines are accurate with what is being. Can I steal yours from
you?
Yeah.
That one
here.
Oh, sure. You could have Colleen give us a story, background. You could get Colleen to give us a background.
Yep. Any issues with the timeline?
No.
Okay. No. Can I just ask a question? The date of complaint is the date that that occurred? Is that...
That's you.
That is me. That's the date of the occurrence, is that correct?
Yes.
Thank you.
May I speak?
Sure.
The incident, that was the date that I made the complaint. It wasn't the date of the event. The date of the event was September 5th.
Yes. Okay.
In 2015.
Is that an error in this timeline?
Yeah, that's not reflected.
Submitted.
That's, The date of the event doesn't seem to be reflected on here.
Right. It's just the, these are the dates of when we were notified of stuff going on.
Okay.
Okay.
Yep.
So in the summary, in our summary documents that we reviewed, would you like to give us a summary of? I'll give you a name so that everybody knows who you are.
My name is Colleen Giorgio. I met Nancy Sunflower at the regional shelter in Montague, and she explained me about the incident she had with Valerie's dog. I told Nancy I will try to contact Valerie. I left notes on Valerie's door. Valerie called me and we talked. She apologized for the incident and she did admit the dog took off and went after Nancy. And I thought that was very nice from Valerie. She apologized and she admitted the accident happened, went after Nancy. And I talked with Nancy and I told her, and Nancy told me she's afraid of not only her, there are other people which are afraid of walking their animals or their kids by Valerie's house because the dog is barking at the door and he can go through the screen. It's true. Sometimes they do plow through the screens and they get on the street. And it's true, can accidents happen. I called back Valerie. I left her a message. She called me back. We talked. I explained her. At that time, at the first time I talked with her, the dog was up today because I checked with the town clerk. It was up on the rabies, but it was getting close to the expire date. So I told Valerie, I remind her to do the license for the dog. And a month went by, and I called her again, and she was busy. We all are busy, and we understand that. And she had to do the rabies vaccination, and that's why the dog is licensed only for 1 year, because the rabies vaccination.
That's.
And I've been checking the street often, probably once in 2 weeks. I go by, people try to turn around, and there was no auctions. So.
Okay. Would you like to start with your side of the issue?
Sure. This was the incident that Colleen is describing. Was the third event. 2 years prior, in February of 2013, the dog exited the front door, the screen door, because it could jump up and down. It's a big dog. Exited the front door, came over, and took the back end of my 10-pound chihuahua in its mouth. The dog let it go. The woman, the owner, came out, and Valerie came out. We've never really met except for those times. And we discussed it. She apologized. I accepted her apology because accidents can happen. Things can happen. Dogs don't always do what you like them to do. We talked about the need to keep the dog under control, and I didn't call the police because I thought it was an okay neighborly conversation, and I was satisfied. On May 22nd of that year, I was walking my five-year-old at the time, Border Collie, past 5 Beaver Drive. And the dog at 5 Beaver again exited through the front door. It was a screen door, not the inside door, the storm door, you would call it. He or she came directly over to my collie, bit my collie on the head, puncture wound. Valerie came and got the dog out. I went home, looked at the dog. It had a puncture wound. It bled. I'm a retired nurse. I didn't think I needed to go see a veterinarian, and I watched it. I went back to Beaver Drive and informed her that I was going to make a police report, and I did make a police report, which I have here. And I learned that 10 day later, I learned that a 10-day quarantine was issued on the dog because it's due when you have a dog bite, whether it's a human or another animal. Over the following months, the dog continued to bark at that door and the windows. And the front interior door at that point was kept, which opens to the inside so the dog couldn't push it open, was kept closed most of the time. Sometimes the door would be open. On September 5th of this past year, 2015, I was walking a dog that I was fostering for the sheriff's office shelter. It was pretty dark out, getting close to dark, and I walked past Seven Beaver Drive. I heard a vehicle and voices. You just glance around because you want to be aware of what's going on. I saw the dog, the Weimaraner. I picked up the Chihuahua, the little tiny thing, held it close to me. I walked more onto Yellow Farms Road, thinking maybe I could get away. I turned my back. It was hot that night. I had on short pants. The dog came up, grabbed my pants. Luckily, the pants were big and baggy, and it didn't break my skin. Pulled my pants down, which I informed the whole neighborhood in a very loud voice. And they came in. They called the dog. They came and got the dog. And Valerie did apologize, but its apologies aren't third incident, not enough. I continued to protect the Chihuahua. I was very upset. Oops, sorry. And I walked home. I called the Deerfield police. They came right out, and I made another police report to the officer. I also called the Franklin County Sheriff's Office 24-hour cell phone to report the incident because it was their dog. It wasn't my dog. And the next week, I also reported to Colleen, as he said. I learned at that time the dog again was placed on a 10-day quarantine. I have spoken with neighbors who won't walk kids by. I've seen the dog bark at the door when people are walking babies by in strollers. It's just a threatening kind of feeling when it's so unpredictable. I was told, I think that's my pitch. That's okay. The facts as I recorded and remembered them.
Anybody here else to speak on that side of the, excuse me for not having the right terminology down, but on that side of the issue?
No, I didn't invite anybody to speak because...
Well, it's a public hearing.
Oh, okay.
We invited the people to come. So if there's somebody else, I need to open up that.
I get it.
For Avenue. Your turn. Please introduce yourself.
I'm Val Talega.
Thank
and
you.
I live at 5 Beaver Drive. I live there. It's just myself and my two young children. Everything that Mrs. Sunflower is saying is, you know, about the occurrences did happen. The issue with the front door is that my son at the time is 3 years old-ish, and it did occur in, you know, good weather. At the time, I was married, and my husband would be outside cutting the grass or, you know, doing yard work or whatever, so my son would be going in and out of the door. And so I do remember the first specific time that was the issue, is that he wasn't shutting the door because he's 3 years old and he's coming in and out. And, you know, just like she said, the dog ran up and barked at her, circled around her, and we were able to, you know, obviously get the dog back in the house very quickly. She didn't report any injuries. She did come over to my house and have a stern conversation with me in front of my children in my backyard. She came up to my fence in my backyard and was kind of yelling over the fence, which, you know, I understood. She was upset. I mean, I would be scared if a big Weimaraner came charging out of the door at me. So I felt, you know, really sorry for that, that had happened. And the second time was pretty much the same scenario. I believe that my toddler had left the door slightly ajar. And again, Kobe got out. His name's Kobe. He's a male, Hawaii Mariner. Right now, he's about 9 years old. So he did go out and again advance upon her. But to my knowledge, she never made contact either time. And I did ask her if her dog was injured, and both times she said no. The second time, she did say, well, he pulled out like a tuft of fur, but she didn't mention anything about any kind of injuries. And then the third time, it was daylight. I had taken the dog for a walk. We both took the dog for a walk on a leash on the bike path, like behind the railroad down River Road. And so we pulled up in my driveway, and my front door is like 10 feet from the driveway, so it's just a very short walk from the car to the door. And we exited the car. We were walking into the house when we heard her, well, I'll speak for myself, but I heard her yelling at me. She was way down. She was like two houses down. So she was yelling at us, which got the dog's attention. And then he turned and took off and bolted for her. And I was right behind him. I mean, I knew exactly what he was going to do. So I ran as fast as I could behind him. And I watched him circle her, bark at her. But it was daylight, and I was right behind him, and he in no way, shape, or form touched her. There was no contact because I was right there. I was right behind him, and I was able to quickly yell at him and tell him to get in the house. And I do have a witness that was there that I brought with me. She didn't contact me after that third incident. I didn't hear from her. She just was screaming at me as I was bringing my dog in the house, but she never came back to talk to me about the third incident or report to me that the dog had pulled her pants down. And I, you know, I do feel very badly that those three incidents occurred, but my dog has never hurt anybody. He has never caused any injury to anybody. He's actually a really, really loving dog that my kids have grown up with. I'm a registered nurse, and I work with very ill psychotic psychiatric forensic patients, some of who have actually murdered people. And, you know, I mean, I need my dog. I'm a single mom, and I feel very protected by this dog. He does bark at the windows. My toddler at the time is now 6.5 years old and completely understands the gravity of the situation and doesn't leave doors or windows open. We never have our front door open. It's always shut. I also have a 15-year-old who is, you know, very cognizant of, you know, Mrs. Sunflower's fears. My next door neighbor offered to come here and testify on my behalf because he gets along very well with the dog. My neighbors on the other side love the dog. People come over and pet the dog and give it bones. He's not a vicious dog. I have, you know, my kids have friends that come over all the time. He doesn't bite people ever. He doesn't ever bite people. But he's protective, and he doesn't like when other dogs walk in front of my house, so he barks at them. But he doesn't bite. He's not a biter. So I've you know, made sure that my door, in fact, I don't use the screen anymore. There's now glass in both of my storm doors. I've made efforts to make sure that there's no screen that he could jump out of, which he's never done. He's never busted through a screen. The times that it happened, the door was unlatched, and then, you know, I take responsibility for getting out of the car with him. I didn't put a leash on him because I was 10 feet away from my front door, and he listens on command. So, you know, I understand that she's scared, and I would be scared too if a 120-pound dog was barreling at me. So I really understand that fear, and I've made every effort to make sure that it won't happen again. My kids are aware of how serious it is and that their dog could be taken away if it happens again.
Anything you want to add?
The fact of the matter is, on September 5th, the dog was coming at me before I said anything. I did not draw attention. The dog came at me. And the fact of the matter is, the dog did grab a hold of my shorts and did pull them down. I took the shorts home. I took a picture of the teeth marks in the shorts, which I showed Colleen. So the fact of the matter is, the dog did bite me. The fact of the matter is, the dog did bite my small dog in February of 2013, and it did have a puncture wound. And the third time, I'm not going to go over and visit. I have spoken with the neighbors on the west, whom I'm also friendly with. They're good people. A bunch of issues. A 6.5-year-old kid can't be counted on to be able to manage a 120-pound dog. It's just my wild guess. The dog's license lapsed. Its rabies vaccine lapsed. I need to know that there's going to be some kind of consequence. I don't want to have this happen again. A couple of weeks ago, I think it was probably you, the dad was picking the kids up, and the teenage girl was there, and I saw that the little boy was coming out of the house, and I said to the teenage girl, "Is your dog secured?" And so she said to her brother, "Shut the door," and I think your daughter went up and did shut the inside door. And that was just a couple of weeks ago. 120-pound dog is a big dog. It's a big dog.
So he's not my father. Kid's father.
So I'm not the father.
Oh, well, you're the guy I saw there, I think.
I was not the guy that you saw. You're mistaken about that.
Then I apologize. It was a wild guess.
I was there, though I did witness the incident in September. And I'm actually shocked. I had not heard at any point in time that she was... was saying that the dog had attacked her. I saw the entire event. The dog was not more than 3 feet from her at any point in time, or not less than 3 feet from her at any point in time, and he never touched her. I would swear to that. I watched the entire event. It's interesting because I was over there a couple of times this week and watched her walk past the house twice. The dog didn't bark. She apparently is not threatened to the extent that she refuses to walk in front of the house. She's done that at least twice this week. The dog, I've known the dog for the last 8 months. He's never, ever done anything to me or anybody else. He's a sweet dog. He is protective. He does bark, but he is absolutely not a threat to any humans or other dogs, for that matter. I've never seen that dog do anything. Except be threatening of, and bark, but no biting at all.
I actually had to foster a dog for a couple of months, so I brought another dog into my house, which would normally really annoy other dogs, and I mean, I've never seen my dog so happy. He played with this dog, and you came to my house and saw the brown lab that was in my house, and I explained to you it was my ex-husband's dog that I was holding on to while his house was renovated. They don't know each other, but this brown lab came into my house, and I mean, my dog just loved him to death. they never fought. He never injured that dog. You know, I truly feel a tremendous amount of compassion for her, and I am so sorry that those three incidents occurred. It was like horrible timing, especially the third incident. It was just the worst timing. But I have truly taken a lot of measures to make sure that my dog is in control, and I don't count on my six-year-old to keep my dog in control. That's my responsibility. But I do, as a parent, make sure that he's aware, as well as my 15-year-old daughter. And, you know, a couple of weeks ago, she did yell at my daughter, who, you know, she came inside and she was very upset and angry because all she was doing was going to the car to get something and coming back in. The door was latched, the door was shut, and she, you know, was very disturbed by Mrs. Sunflower yelling at her. So it's become sort of a hostile situation, and, you know, my kids are feeling really kind of disturbed by her behavior towards them, and afraid that she's going to yell at them. And so they're very nervous about the situation and very aware of the situation, to the point where it's sad, because it's, you know, obviously nobody likes to have issues in the neighborhood. It's a very small neighborhood with, we've all been there for a long time. I don't know how long she's lived there, but I've lived there for 9 years or so now. And both of my neighbors to each side of me are very friendly with my dog, and I'm very friendly with them. And in fact, Bud, my next door neighbor, I'm not sure if you guys know Bud, he works for the town, but Bud was more than willing to come tonight and speak on my behalf. And I told him that wasn't necessary, but...
And he is the neighbor to the west that she's referring to, I believe. You had a conversation
with
him?
Yeah, I had a conversation with him just a couple of weeks ago where he told me he was completely stunned and disappointed that she was trying to have this happen, because Kobe's been such a great neighborly dog to have.
Yeah, but you understand it's happening because of the fear.
Absolutely, which is why I have, you know, the utmost compassion for her. She's scared, and I don't blame her.
Excuse me, may I? People forget that two of my dogs were bit on two occasions. I was bit. I don't need your compassion. I need you to control your dog.
Which I've done. Nothing has happened in more than 6 months.
Right.
Nothing.
Have you walked past her house?
I have dogs myself.
Have you walked past her house?
I'm not going to be a hostage in my neighborhood.
I'm just asking, have you walked past her house?
You said previously that you've seen me walk past her house.
So are you still afraid of her dog?
I sure am. I sure am.
Okay.
I sure am. Because, you know, because there's no consequence.
It's okay.
There are consequences.
It's understandable, yeah. And I totally understand her being afraid, but nothing has happened in over 6 months. I mean, we haven't had any issues at all. He's getting old. He's not in very good health. He's not going to be around for too much longer. He's my family dog. My kids love him.
All right. Anything new need to be added? Anything from the audience would like to?
And I'd also like to point out, he is up to date on his rabies. He's licensed. He's legal. You know, I went through a divorce.
It's okay.
You know, I let it lapse for a short period of time.
I've been trying to follow this, and I'd like to ask two questions. I'd like to ask two things. One, I'd like to ask the animal control officer to give an opinion on whether this dog is aggressive or non-aggressive. That's one. And the second thing, I can't figure out, going back and forth, who wants what. That hasn't been stated, or what's to be accomplished from this hearing. I haven't heard that.
That's not my job, man. So
I will.
I will answer the first one. I'll get the first one answered for you. The second one, I can read between the lines as to what people want. So I'm not looking for the obvious one because I'm not, I think it's necessary.
When I was there, the dog wasn't aggressive to me. But that doesn't mean the dog is not aggressive to other people.
Mm-hmm.
I had dogs which they were aggressive to me and they bit, but they weren't aggressive to other people. It's, we cannot read their mind, but they can read our mind.
Correct.
And it's true, if you are afraid of the dog knows that. When I was there, I wasn't afraid of the dog, and the dog acted normal to me.
May I address that?
Sure.
I have an 85-pound Doberman Pinscher that I walk around. I train him. I have fun with him. I'm enjoying my adolescence finally. I volunteer at the shelter, Franklin County Sheriff's Office Regional Dog Shelter. I walk pit bulls. I walk all kinds of dogs. I handle dogs that other people won't handle because I'm fairly good at it. When you're 75, 50, 75 feet away from a house, the dog doesn't have a clue what your feelings are about the dog. I'm not afraid, let me finish. I'm not afraid of dogs, as Donald Trump would say, I'm not afraid of dogs, but I've been bitten by this dog and I've had this dog come out of the house two other times and bite my dogs. That's the bottom line. What do I want? I want consequences. I want to know what, minimally, and I know that this is a rare happening in Deerfield. Minimally, there has to be a consequence if this happens again. Bottom line, what do I want? I want to feel safe and secure in my neighborhood. I want to be relaxed. I want to be happy in my neighborhood.
Well, I'm not sure that the Board of Selectmen can fulfill that wish because neighbors are neighbors.
Sure.
There are consequences. I've had two dogs put down in my tenure here, even though it does not happen that often.
No.
One was voluntary, and one we went through the whole messy consequences of the process. But the consequences are by the nature of the actions of what happens. It's not based upon the wishes of an individual or the thought process. We've got police reports, and the police never reported anything that indicated anything of a very violent nature. We have people have been in the house. We have the lack of neighbors wanting to jump on the either side of this fence. So from my personal, not the Board of Selectmen's, my personal opinion, there's not enough here to act on. Because basically it's just a he said, she said issue. And basically the thoughts are, you know, you all have consequences. And as you said, the consequences of you walking by somebody's house is what happens from that house. So it's, I can't draw those consequences until I know exactly what has happened. And there's no an alien proof that there's a vicious, violent dog there. There is a scare or a fear.
Let me remind you that there are two. I'm not asking for the dog to be put down because that's a horrifying thing. It's just not a nice thing. And dogs are what I do. Dogs are my fun as a retired person. There are two police reports.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's not a he said, she said event. They're police reports.
Yep. I read through the reports.
Yep, I know you did.
Non-committed to any actions that need to be done. They're the police.
Well, the dog was put on a 10-day quarantine for both times. That indicates that there was a known bite.
I don't understand that piece. I don't know anything about my dog being put on a quarantine.
I talked with you. I told you you have to keep the dog inside for 10 days.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Okay, so that's the 10-day quarantine.
I didn't know if that meant you take the dog for 10 days.
No.
Okay.
No. The quarantine, it's over the owner's house.
Gotcha. And the quarantine is a consequence of the dog biting another animal or a human being.
Yeah.
For rabies.
That's correct.
It's involved rabies, but on her case, the rabies vaccinations were up to date. So the virus, it's out of the case. Okay. There is no...
The state law does say, though, I believe, that the 10-day quarantine is whether the dog has a rabies vaccine or not, because...
Yes. You've got to check into it.
Right. You have to watch the dog.
Watch the dog for rabies, yes.
Right, right.
And that's just the cautious thing to do. So the consequences were there, and they lived the requirements of the consequences.
Okay.
Do you have any other questions?
Well, I guess what strikes me is that the time frame of the incidences were from February of 2013 to September 2015. So we're talking, you know, 2.5 years of 3 incidences. It wasn't like it occurred, you know, in a short period of time. I agree with Ms. Sunflower that she shouldn't feel stressed out about this. But it does seem like you are aware of the situation and that you are trying to keep the dog from being a threat to Mrs. Sunflower. And that's very important. And I appreciate the fact that you admit that there was issues and, you know, that you apologized. You know, animals, you can't control your animals all the time. There could be possible instances. But clearly, you know, the dog is threatening to Mrs. Sunflower. And so I guess I would say that I would take no action on this myself. But I guess before I would commit to saying that, I want you to make an assurance to us as a select board, a hearing board on this, that you will do everything you can to make sure the dog is, you know, kept from threatening the neighborhood.
Absolutely. I mean, that is my
absolute priority. And it does appear that you're very sincere about that.
I mean, it's my top priority. I have air conditioners in my house that I installed. I bought and installed air conditioners so that I don't even have to open my windows, just because I know she doesn't like when the dog barks at her. I don't want her to feel scared. I feel so horrible about that because she has literally no way to walk her dog other than having to go by my house. She has to go by my house.
I have cut through neighbors' yards.
I know, and I've seen that. And I feel, when I see her do that, I feel horrible because I know that if, you know, Kobe, she would love my dog. My dog is such an awesome dog. If she could come in my house and meet my dog, she would know that he's not a vicious dog. I don't know what is going on, why this has happened 3 times just to her. It's just, I just can't believe how ridiculously uncanny it is. It makes me so upset because I totally understand why she's scared, and I feel horrible. I'm a psychiatric nurse. I mean, I don't want anybody to feel afraid or threatened to walk by my house. That's the worst feeling.
Well, and that's why I'm willing to, you know, have no action on this, because I feel that you are sincere and that you are trying, and you do understand that it is very uncomfortable for her and possibly threatening to her smaller dogs at
Absolutely.
Least.
Absolutely.
And to other people in the neighborhood. This is not it's not...
Well, you know,
I appreciate the select board. I appreciate your comments. I honestly do.
We're only here based on what we have for facts, and, you know, nobody brought anybody else in to say anything else. So we're just, it's based on what is said here tonight. So, I'm hoping you guys can work it out, because, you know, for us to take any action on this, it does. It's a sincere, you know, it's really a serious thing. So I guess my thought would be to not take any action and just warn that this, you know, we would have to have another hearing if there is another event, and there would have to be serious consequences at that point. You know, normally we would recommend that, you know, you have restrained the dog, you put up a fence, but clearly, you know, the dog is in a fenced yard.
I have a fence.
And you are making every effort to restrain the dog. But, you know, we are going to be having spring pretty soon again, and, you know, things are happening and kids come and go, and just try to, you know, really talk to your kids and make sure the doors are closed and you know, restrain the dog.
I've actually made it so neither of my gates can be opened because I don't want there to be any chance that somebody leaves the gate open. So my gates can no longer open. In order to get my lawn tractor, I have to use an electric screw gun to dismantle the fence to mow the backyard. I mean, that's how committed I am to making sure this never happens again.
Well, I mean, I have to say, I feel like you're really sincere, and that, you know, has convinced me that we really don't want to do too much more on this. But I have to say that if there's another incident,
I understand
that, you know, we don't have much choice at that point.
And I appreciate that very much. I'm satisfied.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And hopefully you can get together and
Well, we don't have to get together. We just have to enjoy the neighborhood.
But maybe you can go and meet the dog. And
I don't want to meet the dog. I meet dogs all the time.
That's true.
That's true.
Sure. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. Very much so. I think enough has been said, so I am very sorry for the fear that's expressed. I'm also understand the consequences of what I have to deal with. So I have to agree with you at this point in time. There's nothing I can recommend beyond what you've said. So at this point, I'd like to close the hearing and make it formal that there are no actions required out of this meeting. And please have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa. Thanks. Appreciate it. There's Talika.
We have meeting minutes.
Motion that I only see the February 5th meeting minutes, but make a motion we accept January 13th,
sure.
January 25th, yeah. And January 27th.
I'll second that. Any further discussion?
Nope.
And we're going to put all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And the one that's going to be put on hold is the
5th.
February 5th.
Yes, I'm sorry. They're not prepared yet.
That's okay.
I thought I had them, but I guess I don't.
That's all right. I just didn't have it. If it you did have them, I didn't read them anyway, Doug.
It doesn't hurt to have it on the list so we don't lose track of it. Public comment. We have
Dick.
Dick Kalaszewski, who's not public.
I'm not public.
He's not public.
I just came to give the board an update on the status of the meeting you had 2 weeks ago dealing with the school roof. Okay. I reviewed the documents that were available to me. I've had several questions regarding the design of the roof, okay? I've made attempts to contact the RDA design group and the Pink Company, ROPM, and I have not been successful in getting the information I need. So at this point, I have to say that my review of the thing is incomplete. And I have design questions that if you were to ask me if I was to issue a building permit today for that roof design, I would have to say no. I would deny it. And what I'm asking is I've had Mr. Finn contact RDA, Patty Kavanaugh's contacted RDA. I've sent an email to them. All the replies have been, we'll get you the information. Unfortunately, nothing has been forthcoming. So I'm really looking, you know, like I haven't got anything done here. I'd like the board to inform Pink and Company and RDA that they need to respond.
Well,
Doug probably can give you a little input too, because.
Well, I think that Doug and you need to get together along with Ms. Kavanaugh to write down a timeline of what things have occurred and when, and I think we need to send that to IDA. Is that correct?
RDA,
and Pink and Company, and inform them that as their tenor at our meeting was that they weren't going to be able to finish the roof because we didn't meet their requirements for financial aspects. We got our financial house in order, and they don't seem to have their their job responsibilities in order, and that we're going to hold them responsible for the road, for the roof not being done in the appropriate amount of time because of the time that it has taken for them not to respond.
Dick, have you been able to call anyone at the state on the consequences? Yes, this is a state, you know, the Pinkin Company was assigned to us by the state. And I have to say, I am not impressed in the fact that they are, you know, have not responded to you. They're supposed to be our advocates. They're supposed to be checking the calculations. And they don't have the calculations? How can they? They're not doing their job.
I don't have any calculations, and that's one of my main issues. I researched the building code completely, and from the calculations that I have, I sent an email a week ago Monday informing RDA that I felt that the information I have fell outside of the Mass Building Code, and therefore I can't issue any permit. I need that corrected, or I need the information that explains, you know, that it, how it meets the code, and I haven't gotten that. And Mr. Finn has also iridiated the same thing by telephone on Monday. Patty Kavanaugh did that on Tuesday, and they kept promising that it, basically the check's in the mail. And so
have we contacted Kelly?
We have not contacted the OPM at this point, at least
I have an email back.
Have you?
I have an email back from Alicia Tony.
Okay.
No, she relinquished her on duty sites to go through Kelly. And
that was in the future.
No, I got the impression that it was
Alicia Tony remains the sort of executive administrator of the project,
right.
Where Kelly Claffey is the sort of project manager, local project manager.
And hear me out for my fears. I mean, my problem is the fact that if we don't follow chain and get the information to the right people, we end up having the pointing of fingers to somebody that we didn't contact the right person, we didn't do the right thing. So I'd highly recommend that you include her into any future emails so that they can't say they didn't know anything about it.
That's not a problem at all. And before our last meeting 2 weeks ago, I sat down with the engineer that did this design and went over every single page and listed my concerns written down, okay? And then went over it again when I didn't, you know, by email, it doesn't meet the code. And what I'm really looking for is I'm looking for the Board of Selectmen to clarify that, you know, they need to report back in a timely manner. Apparently, I'm not high enough up in the food chain to get that out of them.
Well, I don't think you're going to find anybody high enough on the food chain to have a Massachusetts Board of Municipal Buildings approved DECAM certified group to do anything that they don't want to do.
That's bogus.
The only thing we can do right now is cover the contract requirements, make sure they're documented appropriately, put it to those people and do it. We're going to ask. That's what Doug's going to do with this. He's going to forward the information to them and ask it from the Board of Selectmen. That's who we get our speak through. But the same aspect of it is you can't allow them to pit one against the other at this point in time. You need to shotgun the information to all the people in Trent, CC them all so that nobody can say, I didn't know. Because basically that's the way it's going to get tied up in court if it ever goes to court. Right now, we're with what they told us 2 weeks ago was that if we didn't move forward and they didn't do the work that needed to be done starting from that point, and I think February 3rd was a grace period, we weren't going to get the roof done.
Well, my understanding is they've stopped work.
Well, again, hearsay is not going to get us anywhere, but realization is they had it on record saying that basically, in a meeting that we televised, that if we didn't get this done, our finances in order by a certain period of time, that basically the roof was going to have to wait for another year. We did what we were required to do. We certified that we've got what we need. I want to make sure that if there's any damages done to that roof waiting another year, they're held responsible for it. And the only way you could do that is good documentation.
And we get our money back for what we've already paid out for a flawed product. But what we need to do is make sure that we are CCing in the state on this, because these people were assigned to us. And nobody authorized, I mean, they told us that they needed the money so there would be no gap in their works, the stream of work. We covered the money until we have our vote. And so who authorized RDA to stop working? I have no idea.
The OPM. Actually, I do have it on firsthand authority from Gene Raymond, who's the principal of RDA, that he was told by the OPM to stop work. They're not actively working on the 100% construction documents. And they have said that they were told that there was no money to pay them, and therefore they shouldn't work until money becomes available.
Can you send us a letter to that effect?
I can call to confirm that and then ask that.
Would you request that they send us a documentation to that effect?
Have we notified them that we did get our financial situation all squared away, so it should be a go? And,
yes.
And I agree with what you're saying as far as you CC everybody and anybody that's involved with this. So
you get every dime back.
But I also understand Dick's frustration because he's talked about this in 2 weeks, you know, ago, brought it to their attention, and there should be a response because I talked to Dick about that a little bit too. I was concerned about those live load and dead loads on that roof too, on the existing structure underneath. And, you know, I think those questions need to be answered fairly soon because you've got a town that's going to go to vote on this. And I think that's a little unfair to ask the residents of Deerfield to vote on this without having the basic answers as far as even if your roof structure that's existing is going to be able to support this additional weight.
The money aside,
right.
I think it's horrible that they would even have proposed a design that puts our kids at risk. This is a safety issue.
Right.
It's not negotiable at all.
Right.
And the fact that Dick has questions about it and then he gets no response really makes me angry.
Right.
Really angry.
I have to admit,
everybody's rushing and accommodating this OPM that was assigned to us, Pink and Company, and you know, I don't know what's happening with them, but they sure are not advocating for us, and they are sure taking a big chunk of change to be in our corner, and this does not seem to be the case. And
I agree with Mark.
We need to document it, really. Right.
That's associated with this, whether it be state level, the architect, whatever, should be contacted and everything in writing, and so we cover our bases.
And the thing about it is, you know, it's twofold. It's one is the fact that we're scared about doing the roof because of the reputation which we're deriving from the actions that people are taking. That being said, we've got a bad roof that we need to deal with because if not, we're going to have damage to the walls and everything else. So
that's putting us in a bad situation again.
So having to cover the bases on both of those, we need to make sure that we've got our timeline, we make sure that we've got our documentation, and it has to be formalized. It can't be phone calls that said this to that because we just saw three people that couldn't agree with what they saw in the same realm of, so the reality is it's got to be well documented, it's got to be put down, and we, you know, we do have to give them the chance to respond, but the reality is I'm not comfortable with what's happening at this point in time, and basically for them to basically blow off 2 weeks. And I think that your words, I hope you, this is not sarcasm or criticism, but your words hold a lot more weight than the Board of Selectmen do.
I understand.
And my, your authority for building commission is a whole lot more impressive than what I could do by sending a letter.
You're right, Mark. And what I'm doing is I'm informing you with the information that's available to me today and what they provided. Also, information I have from an independent engineer who did an analysis on that roof 5 years ago when we had a heavy snow on it. Okay? My documentation indicates that more weight added to that roof does not conform to the Massachusetts Building Code. And all I want, and they told me, the engineer sat in this chair right over here and said to me, I have those calculations. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Through the grapevine, I've heard they can't find them now. Okay? So, did I hear that personally? No, I got that secondhand. But those calculations should have been on one sheet of paper. Very simple, very easy to do. I did some simple mathematical calculations. I called the state building inspector. I called another structural engineer friend of mine. I've called another building inspector. And they've all said exactly the same thing I've said. Don't move any farther forward until you get that information.
Right.
So that's where I am. And should
I
keep
calling
RDA and keep emailing them? I feel that we've all said enough to them where they need to respond. And if this is the tip of the iceberg, if they're going to do this before we start construction, what am I going to go through when they start?
I know.
That's my issue now.
Well,
I'm not comfortable with the way they're operating.
I don't know if anybody in the room that is comfortable. I don't think anybody's disagreeing with you.
So,
but other than...
Well, we have to do... Doug will send another email.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, because we've got to...
That's basically what I'm asking.
We've got to document enough so that we can go to the state and make a complaint.
All I'm asking
and
is...
And also get our money back, Dick.
To Doug contact them, because they don't seem to want to talk to me. Doug contact them for the Board of Selectmen. Tell them we need this documentation. Put a deadline on it, okay? Hopefully it's fine and it works out, and I can say, gee, I just got too nervous over nothing. But I need that put to bed. And they need to understand that they need to do this in a timely manner.
I want to just point out a couple of things, if I may. In the absence of a couple of the folks who have been named here tonight, I want to make sure that everybody's aware that I have been in communication with both Patty Kavanaugh and Marty Barrett to talk about this particular problem, this concern. Both Patty and Marty are aware that the Finance Committee last Tuesday approved the $3,875 or $3,850 necessary to bring the construction up to March 10th, or the submission of the 100% construction documents. The OPM has asked for a letter from the board, basically saying that the appropriation has been made and that the project can proceed up to this point. And that letter, of course, was written and signed by the board. But, of course, last Friday at the board meeting, the chair of the board requested that I hold the letter until such time as Mr. Kalaszewski's concerns are addressed. So we have the money. We have the letter stating go ahead with the project. But the Board of Selectmen chose to hold on that authorization. That being said, the transfer has been made. The money's in the account, and the school committee or the school building committee has the authority to expend that money in that account. In my mind, I'm rolling through all the possibilities. They can just write a check preemptively, but they can't. We can't write a check unless we've been billed. The last reckoning that I got from the town accountant is that there was about $113,000 still in that account that hasn't been expended, that hasn't been billed out, $110,000, $111,000, something like that. So there's money to pay for the work that'll carry us to within 2 days of the 100% construction documents. There's no reason to hold on the project at this point. I don't understand why that's happening.
Could you send an email clarifying that we did, in fact, authorize the expenditure of money?
No.
Or the Finance Committee authorized expenditure of money?
They can't authorize it. They can transfer money into their fund.
Right.
The letter that should go, and if you agree,
is simply saying that we have done what we said we'd do, is verified that money is available to proceed, and they should be proceeding as directed. There was enough money to carry them through this period of time, because, but we're not going to authorize things until Dick gets what he needs.
I
don't want to authorize.
I personally think you should drag him out here and say, and have a one-on-one meeting with all concerned, and say, okay, guys, when are we going to get this, and when is it going to happen?
Well, if you want to,
that's just my own personal opinion. But
if you want to put it that basically, we expect the information to be forthcoming to Dick, and if not, to be here on Friday to explain why not. We'll set up a meeting. We'll post it now in case we need it.
That's what I do, Mark.
That way we can. They can't get the information that he needs. We've posted a meeting, and we expect them to be here.
Okay. So I'm contacting the OPM, requesting this information, or requesting that they direct the designer to provide this information, and if they fail to do so, to request a face-to-face meeting to discuss the matter and to determine the cause of the problem.
Right.
Okay.
Does that satisfy you, Dick? I mean, do you feel?
I got to make this statement for anybody who's listening. My only concern here is public safety.
I know.
Making sure this roof meets all the criteria. And I'll just go back and say 6 or 8 years ago, the Sunderland roof was on the floor. And I, in good conscience, we really need to follow up to make sure that's not going to happen in Deerfield.
Absolutely, Dick. Safety issue.
The building is 25 years old. And that's all I'm trying to do is make sure it's safe.
Does that make sense, Doug? I mean, I think that the letter should be addressed to the OPM and CC'd Pink and the engineering firm.
Yeah, everybody here,
and
like
Kelly,
you said, everybody concerned.
And I would CC and send it to the state. And this
Patty
is
Kavanaugh, Marty Barrett, so they're aware of what's going on.
No. Actually, I'm going to be consulting with Patty Kavanaugh and Marty Barrett prior to sending any letter.
That would be good.
And my big concern up to this point, even though I did communicate with Gene Raymond at RDA, I did so, and I was very clear with him. I said, I think I'm outside of the proper chain of command, the proper chain of communication, so I'm communicating to you kind of off the record, trying to give you a nudge to get this information. And Mr. Raymond was somewhat agreeably basically said, okay, yeah, we've got that, we'll get that to you in a day, and that was Monday. But if I'm going to be communicating directly with the OPM, I want to make sure that Ms. Kavanaugh and Ms. Barrett are very aware of that, as Patty's been the sort of business agent for the building committee, and she's also the designated procurement officer for this project. She's been leading the charge all along and guiding it along.
Well, if she has a problem with it, if she has a problem with us doing this, I have no problem with turning it over to her to get the results we need to have happen. Because she is, by right, she is that key person in the middle. So if she doesn't want us to do it, I have no problem with getting a statement from her that she'll handle it so that it falls back on the school hierarchy to get the information we need before we can proceed, making it very clear that we cannot issue, Dick cannot issue a building permit until we get the information.
I think what Mark is saying is it's not a turf war. We're all in this together.
Sure.
What we want to do is just make sure the roof is safe.
I think it's a very good statement, Mark.
And we just want to make sure that there is follow up.
Charge.
I don't.
But we don't want.
Right.
But Dick,
yes.
We don't want the timeline to be, because of whatever's going on, they'll say that we're missed the construction time now.
I think we've done everything we needed to do, and if we miss it, the reason I'm looking for the documentation, and I really would like to make sure you get some really strong bullets, your first 8 or 9 items that you think are your major issues, get them typed up, get them in there, make sure it includes as part of the attachment to the memo that goes out, so that basically they are aware that you have significant concerns and that basically they're documented, because it's easy to ignore a phone call. They can just say it didn't happen.
so.
I already have sort of a base timeline in regard to the communication process up to this point. I'll work with Mr. Kalaszewski to fill out that timeline with copies of the emails that were sent, or at least narratives describing telephone conversations.
Good.
Because having that in the record, definitely, I agree, is going to be important.
Doug and Kevin and myself have been in contact on a daily basis.
In regard to
multiple
this.
Multiple times in regard to this. So we're all, and I... And Kevin apologized. He had something else tonight, so he couldn't be here. Otherwise, he was going to be in on this. So,
no, I think you've handled it quite well.
Dick, thank you very much. I know this has been an awful lot of work.
Well, just in the interest of the safety of the school.
Thank you, Dick.
All right. Any other public comments? Hearing none, selectmen's comments? The Tilton Library is going to, was supposed to have a meeting
This past Monday.
This past Monday.
Yep.
It's going to be 5 o'clock this Thursday, tomorrow, at the library. So it's a change of venue from this location to that location. Mm-hmm. I have two meetings at 7 o'clock, one with the fire district to talk about the ambulance service, and one at Waitley to talk about the ambulance service. So I'm going to see how I can clone myself to be in two different locations at exactly the same time.
Is the Waitley meeting Board of Selectmen or?
Board of Selectmen. Or Building Committee.
Waitley Building Committee.
Waitley
okay.
Building Committee.
Okay.
So,
when is that again, Mark? Excuse me?
Pardon?
When is that again?
Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock.
Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock.
Yep.
Two different locations.
Yeah, one for the fire department and one at Waitley. So,
what do you want to do?
I'm going to see if I can get them to shift the agenda to the second meeting. We'll deal with the South Deerfield Fire Department. I'll catch up with them. I'm not the main speaker at the building committee. The Waitley representatives are there, and hopefully I convince enough people to go support them. So I will talk to them tomorrow and make sure that we're getting the right information. I covered
CDMs. Are you going to be able to make the library meeting?
At 5, yes.
Oh, okay.
I'm on that.
I have a SEEDS meeting at 3:30 at the FERCOG, and that usually goes, you know, a couple hours. So I'll try to get to the library.
If you could get to the library meeting, the more people there to hear the conversation, because this is going to be another major discussion, and get on the information trail sooner than later is probably going to be the best thing that could happen.
Okay. And so that's at the library?
At the library.
Okay.
I don't have anything for the senior center. Anything pop up of interest in the last couple of days?
Just that I've been working with Marlene Johnson on finalizing her budget, and it looks to be pretty locked in. We're satisfied with that. And she did get some good information in regard to the CIC grant, I think, which is helping to fund the outreach efforts that they're doing. So those are going to be funded for next year, and that's good news.
Perfect.
And Marlene's actually very enthusiastic about that. She thinks that a lot of positive can come from that.
Right.
Yep.
She's been spearheading that quite a bit. And we'll be having a Board of Oversight meeting for the Senior Center on, I don't know, check the website. We'll post it. I think it's the 23rd of February.
Is that a Tuesday night?
I think so.
Sounds right. Okay.
I believe that's when it is. So that's all I have other than the roads have been taken care of very well, and we've escaped any other major issues. Had a couple electrical outlets, but I mean service out. How do you call it? Outages. Outlets. Outages. We had a couple of outages because of the storms, but they've been handled very well.
Yep.
Everything else seems to be running fairly well.
Yep.
All right. Board of Health comments.
Just keep washing your hands. It's a lot of illnesses going around.
Mm-hmm.
to sing the entire birthday song twice.
With soap.
With soap, yes.
Discussions.
Actually, before you jump forward, I'd like to remind you of this is one announcement I did put in your packet in regard to a presentation by State Rep Stephen Kulik. It'll be on Saturday, February 27th at 2 p.m. at the Sunderland Public Library. And the reason I'm pointing this out is because he's going to be focusing on the future of renewable energy in Massachusetts. Now, obviously, the big headlines above the fold are all about the Kinder Morgan pipeline, but our representative is also going to be talking about the omnibus energy bill, which is going to be coming before the state senate and legislature, and also the provisions regarding solar in Massachusetts, the so-called solar renewable energy credits program, or SREC-2, actually just expired. The terms of that just expired. The net metering cap also has been reached, which basically puts commercial development of solar energy at a standstill in Massachusetts. I have already written letters in support of raising that cap and encouraging our state representatives and our state senator to do whatever they can to expedite that or to extend the SREC-2 program at least to the end of the year, which will allow for some of the projects that we have in mind here in Deerfield to proceed forward. But barring that, maybe folks in town who have an interest might want to attend this presentation on the 27th and talk directly to Steve Kulik and see what he's got to say about it.
Can you forward this information plus your letters to the Energy Committee?
I will.
And
absolutely.
See if we can help them get some other letters to add to your voice.
Yeah, absolutely.
If they're so inclined, and maybe they can pick up some things we missed.
Yep, there's a lot of people writing to our state reps in favor of extending SREC 2. The MMA, all of the energy lobbyists, the renewable energy lobbyists in the state, and a lot of small co-ops and startups are trying to get some attention to this issue. And
I think we should add our voice.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. If we can.
Anything else under announcements?
That's all I have, personally.
Sorry for not including you in that round-robin.
Oh, no, that's fine. That's fine.
Oh, it should be. A good point. All right, moving on to setting the annual town meetings and open... I thought we already set the meeting. But opening the warrant. And this is for April 15th, 2016.
April 25th, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's in blue. Thank I'm you. Sorry. It's a little funky.
No, it was my reading, not yours. And I'm going to repeat it. It is April 25th, 2016. Doug had a recommendation that we open the warrant tonight and for 2 to 3 weeks. You can always open it up later on but I think it's better to get things out sooner and in there rather than having them be the last minute agenda. So, at the pleasure of the board, as of whether it's 2 or 3 weeks or whatever, but I'm kind of in favor of. Do you have a preference?
No, I'm fine. I just the way the warrant article for the money we set aside for fighting the pipeline, it's for the FERCOG. So
correct.
What we need to do is I just want to make sure we have a warrant article that uses the money. I think this would not be for the town meeting. It would be a special town meeting beforehand. So we could use the money to send to Montague out of this year. I mean, the money's already been appropriated. And if we had a special town meeting, if we have one special town meeting.
There will be a special town meeting before the regular.
All right, then the warrant article would go on the special.
Why would it have to be on the special?
Because we'd want to use money.
The money's going to stay there.
Yeah, but money, forever. Then we could send it to them after the special town meeting vote. And it's money already appropriated. We don't wait till July 1st.
If town meeting votes to transfer or reappropriate that money that was already appropriated, they can do that and it can still be effective.
That at the end of the vote.
At the end of the vote, exactly.
At the end of that night. So it doesn't need to be. It can be either or a special or, but I would rather see it go to the annual town meeting voting. But it's going to be the same population.
I know.
Because it'll be 20 minutes before.
Yeah, they'll happen sequentially.
Oh, okay. As long as it's written so that we can release the money to them. Because I know they've incurred... They only appropriated $10,000 themselves, and I think they've already incurred $6,500 in expenses. So we just want to be able to help them out. But I think it's good that actually that we're waiting until a special town meeting to do this or the regular town meeting, because by then there shouldn't be any discussion about, you know, that we're helping intervene at that point. I mean, in other words, I can't say that we... I mean, the DPU would have already made their decision and it would have been moved on.
Well, intervening status saves through the whole project.
Well, it doesn't this just is, have this to do is with the intervener. This would go towards expenses, towards the intervener's expenses related to trying to end the moratorium. They're hiring an expert... expert on... You know, saying, questioning the Berkshire Gas moratorium. And this is part of the DPU public hearings process.
So we'll be allocating the money from the pipeline to the moratorium issues.
Right.
Just as long as it's well written so that people understand
well,
what they're voting
I mean,
for.
That's actually going to be a significant change. That's not going to just be a transfer of appropriation.
It can be a transfer because you can take the money out of it to fund it. That could be part of your motion, is to take the money from a previous item to fund this one.
Okay.
It's not just a transfer of money in-house. It would be, it's a whole new track. But it's great because it doesn't leave that money hanging out there, not being used. It moves it into something that it can be used for.
Okay.
But it's got to be well written because there's going to, I can see the headlines on that one. So...
Well, we'll have more information as well, because if they might want the money towards the pipeline fight versus, you know, the moratorium. But what their expenses are running up right now is trying to, you know, counter the moratorium.
Right. Well, the thing is, it's
and
not
the moratorium
what
for us is an issue.
Moratorium is an issue for everybody when it comes to energy. I mean, it's not... It's gamesmanship, and I don't appreciate gamesmanship in the thought process, but the reality of it is the townspeople have to vote for what they want. It doesn't matter what the COG wants. The COG has put together a thought process that's sellable to us, and hopefully it's what the townspeople want, but it's their ultimate decision as to how and what happens to it. So we got to make sure it's written right and correctly. So do you want to... make a motion, and how long to keep it open?
I make a motion that we set the annual town meeting, which I think we have as well, April 25th, 2016, and we open the warrant tonight do you want to go to our next meeting or the meeting after that? I think two meetings, don't you think?
The meeting in March will be on March 10th, and that's a full 4 weeks. You can choose to keep it open till March 3rd.
Why don't we do that? Because we should have most everyone's articles in a couple weeks.
Right.
I'm trying to remember David's schedule. I think there may be a meeting on Friday, March 5th.
Well,
could be wrong on that.
Well, then why don't we vote to keep it open till March 5th? We can close the warrant on our March 5th meeting.
That door locked? Is there somebody banging on the door? That's not good.
Dick locked it on his way out.
Publicly moving. We never said the doors were unlocked.
Yeah.
If you can get in, you're welcome, you know.
So why don't we do it till March 5th?
Through March 5th, 2016.
And we can close it at that meeting.
Yeah. Further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
May I ask a question? What does that mean that it's being opened? The warrant's being opened.
We open the warrant so that articles
can be submitted. And so that's officially now, and people have a certain amount
from
of time.
From now until March 3rd, yes.
Okay, I thought so.
March 5th. Right? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I got a nod. Okay. Do I have a motion to sign the warrant for the state elections?
I make a motion to sign the warrant for state election. Do we have that?
We do. There are plenty of copies of, there are two separate warrants, and there's, I think, two or three copies of each. Just sign where your name is. Like I said, there are copies underneath.
Until we voted.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you do need to vote.
Did you second it?
I second it for any further conversation? Hearing none, all those in favor of signing?
Aye.
Aye. I'll keep moving this on. We have a list of poll workers for the elections. It's an annual appointment. It's been submitted by Barbara.
I make a motion. Will you approve the list as submitted?
I'll second that. Any further discussion?
No.
Oh, do you have that? Yeah, right there?
Yeah, I've got it here.
Actually, I thought that was included in the election warrant folder. Oh, yeah, right here. Nope, that's not it.
So I have a list. I have a list.
You have to sign here, Chad. So if you just sign in the line in the lower right, that is
it. Okay.
Very good. All right.
Did we actually vote it?
No,
Mark?
I got it. Did we vote it, Doug?
I don't think you did.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now you voted it.
Now we did.
Now we did. All right.
Only one of these.
Homeroom petition for extending the police service.
I make a motion we approve it as presented.
I'll second that. Further discussion?
Just to remind everybody, this is the petition that was approved by town meeting actually on the 25th, and this is just the petition that will go to our representative, Steve Kulik, and he will then take it before the general court, state legislature, for review and approval.
We don't need to vote it again, then.
Hmm?
We don't need to vote it again, because it was voted at town meeting.
Yeah, you really just need to sign it. Yeah, okay. That's it.
But we already did, so we reaffirm the vote. We have a request to vote to deficiency spend for the road salt, or for the winter road maintenance, snow and ice removal.
Are we getting close?
We're closer than we need to want to be.
Yep. And
I make that motion to deficit spend the winter road maintenance.
Account. A second. Any further discussion? Clarification?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We have some renewal of business permits.
Yes, we do, and I apologize. I need to get the originals for you. Right back. It's actually just for one business, for Mark Fabry Afterworks, and they came in a little bit later than others due to a bit of a snafu with the paperwork.
Do we have any issues from the police department?
There are none. There are none. There's no problems.
And they paid their customary amount? Can't vote it without knowing that. It's not in the package.
It's not in the package, okay.
Yeah, he's going to get it.
All right. I was going to say, geez, I didn't see that.
And I apologize. Did you ask a question on my, as I was running out?
Yeah, did they pay their money?
Yes. They paid the permits. They're up to date on their taxes. That's the actual application and the permits underneath.
Okay. I make a motion to approve this.
I'll second it. Any further discussion on the permit for Afterworks? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Do. All right. We have a chunk in here for the 2017 budget discussion.
Yeah. You did receive a draft budget packet on Friday. Did you actually get a copy of that?
I did.
Oh, you did. Okay. And for the most part, we're
continuing. I reviewed it Monday.
Oh, good.
I didn't have it for the meeting on Friday.
Okay. We're continuing to look at all of those budgets. There were some slight revisions to our legal services budget and our contracted services budget, which I'll make sure that you get an updated copy of. Basically, that was me going back and looking at the last 18 months worth of expenses from those two accounts and trying to come up with a realistic expectation of, you know, trying to tighten the budget down as close as we can within certain safe margins. And I failed on the contracted services. I think we wound up being about $400 higher than the original number, but it was based in reality, so I'm still comfortable with it. The legal services budget, I feel, is still going to be too low, but it's higher than it was for FY16. That's up in $27,400, something like along those lines. Currently, FY16, we're funded at $20,000, and I know that's not enough. That hasn't been enough for 6 years. So as this
gets more higher in its expenditures, I think that we used to have legal services in each major department, mm-hmm. so that it was identified who was using it and how they were being used.
Sure.
And when it got to the point where it was lower, we put it in one bundle to keep a better handle on it.
Sure.
I think that we need to either break it out in subsections so that we know where we're spending more money, and if need be, get it into the departments that are, you know, if it's a department that has its own legal advisory group, like the police department, and who uses mass chiefs and everything else, let them, you know, put it into their budget so that basically we're more true to what the budgets are.
Sure.
I mean,
understand.
It's worth taking a look at as it creeps back up in
or price. Just even split between regular general counsel and labor counsel.
Well, we
yeah.
do.
There's something to that.
The labor counsel. I mean, we yeah. bundled it together, and so the labor.
We bundled together the cost for general and labor counsel, yes. But in the legal services budget, we do distinguish between expenses for police department, expenses for historical commission, assessors down okay. the line. In some cases, actually, that was part of my review. I found that we'd been appropriating a few hundred dollars for a certain given department, you know, agricultural committee, I don't know.
Yeah, I remember
never
the
never spent any of the money, so actually we zeroed that right out.
Yeah.
And it does make sense to do that, to make sure that the request matches a track record of expenses.
Right.
That being said, the general or the administrative appropriation is set at $15,000, and I know that won't be enough. I mentioned that to the finance committee last night. One of the members actually joked and said, you know, I think we're going to need to have to lower that budget, you know, before we get done with this budget season. We're going to have to drop that down a little bit. And my reply was, I'll make sure to time our transfer request for more money for this year to coincide with your efforts
to cut next
year's budget. I'll just make sure that that happens. Well yep. received in the spirit that it was given. But
good.
We're continuing to look at all of our budgets, comparing them to actual expenses, even to date, our FY16 expenses to date and our FY15 expenses, to try to make sure that what's there matches what we're asking for. There's only so close you want to shave before it gets dangerous, before you realize you're going to have to go back and either stop work in May because you don't have enough money, or go back and ask for at town meeting a bunch of additional appropriations because you under budgeted, and that just gets kind of ugly if we're not careful. So,
well, it is, but understanding at some point in time, we have to listen to what the people want, whether it's sustainability or.
Sure.
So, we are becoming more and more cognizant of that as each year goes by.
Sure.
So,
One thing that did come up at the Finance Committee last night, there was a general discussion about the classification compensation plan. I did inform the Finance Committee that we're moving ahead with that class comp study. which is just a comparative analysis of our jobs, pay ranges for each job, and how those compare to other towns around us. That's essentially it. That's all that the Collins Center is actually doing. There was a great deal of interest on the part of the Finance Committee to say that, you know, this needs to be looked at every year. We need to have some kind of vote related to the class comp study, and we need to get this done. It should be brought forward, you know, by the Personnel Committee and by the Board of Selectmen every year, a recommendation for changes to that schedule, to those pay ranges for those jobs. And it hasn't been done in past years, but the insistence was it should be done every single year. And the person who mentioned it threw it right back here at the Board of Selectmen and said it's up to this board to make some decisions about that and the Personnel Board to provide a recommendation for that.
How much did we pay for the Collins review?
The original appropriation was for $10,000. We're paying $4,500 for the Collins work that's being done. It's not a full-blown, proper assessment of every job description
and all of that.
It's only a limited comparative study. Actually, Dylan Kerpita asked if we'd ever done a study comparing municipal jobs to jobs in the private sector to see how they compared. That would be an entirely different animal. I don't even know where to begin with that. So
That's a total... You know, apples and oranges. You have to have somebody do some calculations in Excel spreadsheets that would just boggle your mind.
I would see that was like $25,000 minimum.
I wouldn't doubt that. Yeah, I wouldn't doubt that.
And I really take the...
I'd rather give the people money.
Yeah.
Just to follow up there with the Finance Committee, there was, with Doug, a pretty lengthy discussion last night. I don't know if there was a complete consensus.
Because
there's different views that were shared, but everybody agreed that it needs to be looked into and
the comparison.
We got to move this forward.
Yeah.
What
the local comparison, right?
Part.
Yeah. I mean, what we were doing with the Collins report, right? Okay. We were not doing a full blown.
Right.
You know, and certainly not comparing private to public.
Actually, the Personnel Board, Mary discussed that they were still working on some things. And even if we had to do something to get just through this year, you know, for to address this at annual town meeting and be a little more in depth the following, if need be. So, as far as the timing, and Doug was going to do some research on try to move that forward. Also, with that study,
the
timing.
Yeah, the study will likely be complete in about 3 to 4 weeks. And once we get the results back from that study with perhaps recommended pay ranges, to be able to educate everybody in terms of what those pay ranges really mean is going to be an entire session of a meeting in and of itself, because you've got to take a look at grade three. Here's the range. What jobs are in grade three? Does that jive with my own sense of what's right or wrong, or what's fair, what's not fair? And then make votes on that, or you know, discuss that, explore that. There was only six grades in the municipal side. There's a lot of different jobs with a lot of different qualifications and prerequisites in those six grades. You know, a grade two is an administrative assistant, but also you know, a basic employee at the highway department. Grade four is an assistant town clerk, but is also, you know, a building inspector. You know, I'm making some of these up, but the point is, it's not an apples to apples comparison that says, oh yeah, these jobs both, of course, should be in grade three or grade four or whatever. So it would take some time to digest those changes and really get to a consensus as to whether or not that's appropriate.
That's why there's some discussion about what criteria to use, the evaluation tool, and so on and so forth. It's not as cut and dry as it may appear to some people. It's a little bit more involved.
If you went back to the original, well, the second study that we did, they have a matrix there that we could evaluate.
Mm-hmm.
And for its applicability to the across the board right now, and you can easily make that comparison as to what is different between each part in a grade, because it gave you credit for what education was required, what your job tasks were, you know, the strength requirements.
Who you supervise?
Who you supervise? How many? It was very well done. The problem was that we never got buy-in from the department heads to use it a specific way, and everybody made up their own. And basically,
so is that something that you could pull and share maybe with the finance committee, just so we get, they can look at it?
The original
matrix,
the policy manual, the employee manual.
I have a question for you, and I don't mean this to sound, because I'm not very finessed in my presentations, but why is the finance committee getting into the personnel department?
Well, just because it came up in discussion. Actually, Doug brought it up to the whole finance committee as far as this, as far as the pay grades and rates and so on.
Well, you should be the finance.
So I think it's just a reflection of where we were financially.
Yeah, the finance committee is really going to have to look at whatever we come up with recommendations as to where we're going to go, because it's going to be a difference. But there's a lot of hard work that has to be done, and it, as Doug said, you have to do both an education of the workforce, the management force, the people to do the evaluation of it. The original design of this thing was a 7-year rotation, and there were 10 increments that went from start to finish. So you should never get to the end of this process. Mm-hmm. It should be recalculated in that period to shift it so that basically nobody got
up to the end.
To the end, because it was basically a mindset, but that got forgotten really quick, mm-hmm. and everybody got in tune to what they wanted to see out of it, which is more money. They didn't get in tune with what does the town get out of it. It was in tune with how do we get more, and how does the cost of living increases? Are they fair, non-fair? What is the CPU? What is, you know, all of that stuff got questioned, but nobody ever went back to the beginning of, okay, this is the ground floor. This is how we build our decisions, and stick to it.
Right. There was some discussion last night, and maybe as a little bit afterwards with just one or two members, but I think it's worthy of repeating on camera that, and it actually was educational for me, because up to this point, I had been very serious about my insistence that we need to start doing reviews, we need to start doing employee reviews, we need to tie step increases to performance reviews, and I said that that would only work if we adjusted the class comp schedule upward so that a person who's just living at step 5 for 20 years isn't going to get drowned in debt by the end of it, but that they're at least maintaining some kind of pace with inflation, with cost of living, so on and so forth. But that step increases were a merit thing, that you're doing a better job, I'm going to put you up onto a new bracket, that kind of thing. And I know that I've heard that from you, Mark,
yes.
on several occasions.
Right.
The difficulty, and this is something that was raised, I think, by Skip last night, Skip Olmstead, he said, the problem with doing that in a municipal government is that there's no such thing as salary confidentiality. Everything is public information.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you have an individual who's, you know, I don't know, typing reports and entering numbers and doing that kind of thing on a 40-hour week, and they're getting $13 an hour, but there's someone next to them typing reports and entering numbers on a 40-hour week, and they're getting $15.50 an hour for what looks to be like the same job, and both people know what the other person is making, mm-hmm. it creates a lot of conflict and confusion, and how do you implement that?
I didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead.
I was just going to... It's a consideration I hadn't taken into account.
Well, we have, and the thing is that if, you know, the supervisor who does the evaluation puts you where you fall on that scale, and I'm trying really hard. If I say step, you can hit me. Hit me really hard.
Now we talk
about that. But they put them where they belong in that aspect of it. And if you're not performing, you could stay at that step 5. There you go, hit me. You could stay at that level.
That, let's say, the middle of the range.
The middle of the range.
Sure.
For your whole life, because all you did was show up for work every day.
And if that's a person's level of commitment, so long as they're performing the job satisfactorily, that should be okay.
That should be fine. And there are a lot of people that, you know, all I want them to do is sweep this whole room. Well,
if you do it in 10 minutes or you do it in 30 minutes, the job was to do the thing. If you do it in 10 minutes, I'm going to find other things for you to do, and I'm going to give you a raise because you're doing more things for me. Sure. But if it takes 30 minutes to do it, you're going to get 30 minutes of pay every time you do this, and that's all you're going to get because that's all it's worth.
Sure.
So it's a balanced. It's not cut and dry, and it's not, hey, I'm sitting right beside this person who's typing, and I'm typing. Well, you're typing emails, and you're typing documents, your contracts,
sure.
And they have to be right, and we can correct the email. and that's the department head or the supervisor's position to look at and give them, and if somebody feels that it's not correct, that somebody's getting more than they are, then they raise their hand and say, how come? And we sit down and say, well, this is what's different.
Sure.
And if you want to get this money, you do the same thing this person does to the same quality.
Sure.
We don't do that.
Sure.
No, we're right. Not very good at it. So,
we had high hopes.
Some departments are better than others, and basically, we need to clean it up.
We had high hopes.
And I just want to clarify something. I wasn't finance committee getting involved with this because that's not our position. All I was saying is if we could educate ourselves to be able to understand the finances and be able to make that recommendation. And that's all that was about. That is not about getting into this other business as far as the matrix. And so that's somebody else's job. There's no question about it. In fact, we discussed that last night. That's not up to us. And there was one member that pushed that pretty hard last night. I just wanted to clarify that. That's not the case.
I didn't take it that way as much as... We're at that tenuous point right now where we're having people trying to make recommendations to us.
Right.
In an offside person, our lead people, the personnel committee, and the more people that gets involved in that, the less gets done.
Right, yeah. No, I understand.
Get the recommendations out, let us digest them, and then as we understand it with what their recommendations are, then we start saying, okay, this is what it looks like it's going to mean. Do you guys agree or don't you agree? Or
but bring the more matrix.
It's more of an educational item.
Cool. Yeah.
For us, or at least for myself. I shouldn't speak for the finance committee, but at least for myself.
Yeah, I think that it would be great to have it. That's why I said I didn't want to detract from what you're doing, but understand we've got a lot of other work that...
Sure.
We've got the finance issues. That's just one of which we have to really concentrate on.
Doug can probably dig up at some point the matrix because it is very detailed.
I got it at home.
It's very detailed and it's really a good chart.
It was very good, very well done, and we found problems with it and had to modify it. But anything else on?
The only other thing I wanted to mention is that there is going to be ongoing conversation that I need to have with. The town clerk about the disposition of the energy loan, and exactly the best. I need to get a recommendation from her as to what we should do, whether she thinks we should just pay it off, or whether we should bond for it, and if we're going to bond for it, what the expense would be for that. It's $250,000. It's not huge money, and right now we're paying about $21,000 or so per year on a short-term borrowing. It's like a year-to-year thing. She said we have to either pay it off or bond for it for FY17. We're at the end of that five-year span, that grace period. I need to get a recommendation from her on that. I hope we could do a bond that's a shorter-term bond so we can just get it done, a little bit more painful perhaps in the short term, but get it done.
We had talked briefly about really how much has it saved the town? Dollars and cents wise.
Yeah,
We've got a Cisco report. We should have a some sort of idea. Mm-hmm. And the one thing I want to make sure that people understand is the fact that we have saved money by doing that endeavor. Sure. We borrowed the money, and my understanding was that we would use the savings from the electricity and oil and gas to offset the loan.
Sure.
And we should have been taking bigger chunks of money out of our budgets to pay off the loan because those were things that we saved.
Right.
And then when we got all done with it, we would have had a lion's slide of money that we weren't paying out for stuff to keep us at a little bit more of a sustainable rate.
Right.
So even though I know we didn't do it, we still should tell the people that this wasn't done in vain, that I think the five-year
window, mm-hmm. should have had it pretty close to paid off.
And I want to say that Jeff and why can't I think of his
Bill.
Name? Bill, thank you. Jeff and Bill Cummings did quite a bit of research into the history of that, and kudos on them for doing that. And for the first year or two of that, which I think must have been around 2011, 2012, somewhere around there, for the first 1 or 2 years, it was reported that the town saved about $46,000 in electricity costs in right. each of those 2 years. Fantastic. Great. And like you just said, those money should have been pulled from the budgets of those departments where they that recognize energy savings.
Right.
That wasn't done.
Yeah, and it,
but the town has saved money.
Yeah, it has saved money. Absolutely. And the thing about it is I don't want people to look at this and say, oh, we're paying off this loan, and what did it do for us?
We tried to make that clear last night.
Thank
in the
you
finance
very much.
Committee. We felt, we shared that we felt from what we saw, and obviously we didn't have the full picture, but yeah. we had a pretty good
Well, the rates.
That,
well, the rates went up.
The town did benefit from this.
Right.
It's not like it costs us a huge amount of money or anything. We truly believe that the town did benefit from this energy loan.
And will
right.
because basically.
And the rates went up, so we would have increased the amount of savings. So we would have paid for itself another year or two.
Sorry, John.
That was through the work, you know, a lot of hard work from a lot of people.
It was.
It was an awful lot. It still is. Writing yes. up that green report, that it just...
We're still not off the hook on that.
Still goes. It makes you go nuts. Okay.
I would like to get some direction from the board on two things. One is that salary, the salary levels. The expectation for next year is that, as in past practice, folks have been budgeting for a step increase for employees. And that folks who are at step 10 are budgeting for a cost of living adjustment, which I have set at zero right now. I'm looking for direction from you on what that should be. And remember that this affects maybe 5 or 6 employees all told in the town. Past practice has been somewhere between 1.5 and 1.7%. Do you have any thoughts on that?
There was no cost of living increase this year again, right, for Social Security?
For Social Security, correct.
I thought it did. I thought this is the first one they did it.
They had one in 12, 13, and 14.
Then they skipped
15. Think a 0% was recommended for 16, principally because of the cost of
fuel.
But
we're going into 17.
Well, true.
Yeah, but we base it on their whatever was January 1st.
Okay, I can go and
I think that
do some checking.
If they didn't, the veterans did, or somebody got some government COLA increases, but I think that we can use, you know, common sense is we don't want to give more of a cost of living increase than we're giving to people who are getting merit increases.
Sure.
So whatever we decide to do with this, that should be calibrated to a percentage of whatever, and realize that the compensation is skewed very poorly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I think we should put a little bit more thought in it to make sure it's done in a fair and equitable thought process than picking just a number.
I can also, I mean, our steps are essentially 80 cents apart.
Correct.
I can also recalculate so that the adjustment for step 10 plus is simply what they had last year plus the 80 cents. So that way if it's a grade 1 step 10 or a grade 6 step 10, it's still an 80 cent increase. I can do that. If that's what you want to do.
Let's see what the numbers come out at.
Okay.
With your, you know, 1.5 or 1.7.
Okay.
Give us some we know what we're talking about. I mean, it's just a pie in the sky right now.
Sure. And I'm counting on, I think I can count on one hand the number of people this affects. So it's not going to be a whole lot in terms of the bottom line of the budget, no matter what we do. So, I am meeting tomorrow morning early with, speaking of budgets, meeting
well,
with...
One thing, go ahead. Is that if the department head feels that the person is just meeting expectations, then they should know that they're empowered to just leave them at the level they're at.
Okay.
For the tens.
Okay. I will inform department heads and ask if...
That's opinion at this point, yeah. Not given just... Mark Gilmore, the Board of Selectmen, because we haven't voted it.
Okay.
I mean, that would be my recommendations. Chew it up, see what the other department heads think, see what, you know, see what they,
how they feel about it. And if it's something they feel is reasonable and makes sense, then we'll entertain it. I'm not going to make that decision here as a lone person. So.
Do you have any thoughts, Carolyn, on that?
I just want you to check and see what the Social Security thing was.
Okay.
And then look at the, you know, the salary, what 1% or 1.5% is versus the 80 cents. I mean, I not having anything in front of me to look at is hard to make a decision.
That was the first part. The second part is if people are at step 10 and they're meeting expectations, we should have a rule or we should have a policy.
That's
or
the whole
statement.
Idea of merit pay. There right. should be no merit pay. So, people are just showing up.
Right. So, I mean,
I'd like showing up is important, but that's like a minimal thing.
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So it's just, I mean, I would like to hear their opinions. Mine is that basically, you know, if you get somebody who's been here for 10 years or more and is a stellar performer and you want to give them a little more money, then you should be recommending to us what it is that they get. And if they're just doing their job, then they've gotten to the level. I mean, I hope everybody realizes that when you get to 10 years in a position or 12 years in a position, you must either really, really love it or you're just there. And I don't mean that to be critical, but I like to see people achieve better things, go on, get educations, find better things and fun things to do and improve the town in the same, take us with you, or we take you with us. I just think that we need to be fostering there's better things for you and helping them get there as good employees.
Well, in this day and age, anybody that has a way to save money should be rewarded as well.
Yeah, and that's
so. If you come up with if you come up with ideas and or ways to do stuff more efficiently, and you're working more efficiently, I absolutely want to.
You're having fun doing it, then I can understand.
And whether a person is pushing a broom or driving a bucket loader or a police car, if they can save money, absolutely. I think they should be rewarded in some way to for those efforts. You know, if they're continually dedicating themselves to the town.
And I mean, we have people that are here.
Or our mission. It doesn't, we shouldn't always put saving as a money. But,
right, and that's where I was going.
But enhancing services somehow at the same time.
We have some people that just love their job because they love to interface with people, and they do a great job, and they go well above what a starting salary person would come in and or hourly person would come in and do because they don't either know the faces or... They provide something that the town really needs in community and structure, and that's not something that should be forgotten or lost.
Right. Being nice and being enthusiastic is hugely important, too, in my mind, anyway.
Yep. Oh, I can't disagree. Being happy. It's effective. If you can get people to be happy, you're worth your weight in gold.
Yep.
Okay.
I do have a few other things if we're at that point with town administrator's report. In your packet, immediately after the snow and ice overdraft authorization page, you're going to see a draft complete streets policy. Now, I'm going to give Kevin Scarborough big kudos on this because he pointed me to a couple of resources which allowed me to really, really quickly put together what I think is a very nice, simple, clean, concise, and fairly generic policy. Now, Complete Streets, of course, is the methodology by which public rights of way, public means of access, and transportation are made available to people regardless of their physical abilities or personal abilities, and made available to all modes of transportation, walking, bicycling, skateboarding, mass transit, automobiles. Complete Streets fosters new and different ways for people on bikes and walking to go from one place to another, backwoods walking paths or sidewalks that cut through parking lots, that kind of thing. I am not requesting any action on this, but I'm requesting that you take a look at this policy, and hopefully maybe at the next meeting we can take the next step, have a second reading on it. It does reference some information state and federal resources at the back. I'm doing a little bit of research to find out exactly what those resources say, and I'll be relying heavily on Kevin's expertise in those areas. It also references the Town of Deerfield Department of Public Works Operations Construction Standards, latest edition. That we have to write in order to reference it, but I've given Kevin some heads up and some direction to go with that. Basically, that's something else that I think makes sense for the Town of Deerfield to look at, you know, in another
Doug, just off the top of my head, one thing I'd like to add is just as Deerfield, where you talk about the Deerfield Board of Selectmen and acting as Board of Health, because one of the major funding streams that is available through the federal government now is, you know, keeping your community in motion, you know,
sure.
promoting activity,
yep.
increasing activity level. So by doing this policy, which is wonderful, but also including it as the Board of Health, then it makes us eligible for grants
yep.
through, you know, the federal government. I forget which agency it is that is doing it, but it might be HUD, but I'm not sure. But I've seen a couple things where it goes through. But so this is wonderful.
Okay.
I have to say thank you for doing this, because it could set us up for some potential grants.
This is a necessary first step in order for the town to take advantage of any resources available through Governor Baker's, I forgot the name of the legislation, the Municipal Modernization Act. In order for us to even begin to move on our Complete Streets initiative, we need to adopt a policy. That's step one. And then we'll be available or able to actually apply for some technical assistance grants, which could allow us to actually start designing some of the things that we'd like to do, whether that's repair and upgrade of a sidewalk, whether that's expansion of the town common or adjustment of it, whether that's creation of public parking areas right over there at the old Leary lot, that kind of thing. Those are things that are possible through the Complete Streets initiative. And by adopting this policy, we become eligible for some technical assistance to help us start on that path. So
thank you.
There it is. Here we are. Nice starting point, and we'll be bringing this back again. I will happily accept suggestions.
Where did most of this be derived from?
Actually, a couple of different sources, but I drew very heavily on a policy that was just adopted by the town of Framingham. A lot of this comes from that policy, because a lot of it is, it feels like boilerplate language. It feels like just basic common sense in line with the Complete Streets established practices.
Are we going to get a legal review of this?
What's that?
Are we going to get a legal review of this?
If you'd like to. It's a policy.
Makes sense.
Which generally a policy is a statement of your opinion as to what should
intent,
go on,
right.
what should happen. It doesn't hold legal weight per se, but it does help to drive what departments and employees do inside the town.
Okay.
It doesn't hold the same weight as a bylaw, for example, but
okay.
but I'm happy to run it past legal counsel just for a quick review. Sure.
If you don't think it's necessary, you feel as you're comfortable. I haven't read it, so I can't. I'm just asking questions so I know that
sure.
where my starting point is.
Yep. Consider this to be more like a vision statement.
But I think this is one of the things you have to have for that grant process.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, thanks for doing it.
Sure. The next thing that's in your packet is actually something I was able to just finish this afternoon. Back on December 29th, we issued a request for proposals at long last related to the lease of land up on, where is it?
Potomac Range.
Thank you. It's up on the Potomac Range. For the past 39 years, there's been a tower up there owned and operated by initially Deerfield Cable, and then later Continental Cable, and then later Western Mass Electric. And now, of course, Western Mass Electric operating as Eversource. We were informed that in order to renew that lease, we needed to issue an RFP.
for it, open it up to anybody who wants to respond.
Have we ever done this before?
No.
Because I was going to say, I don't remember.
The 39-year lease that's never gone through public procurement.
Oh, well, because I don't remember any comparison like this. This was a lot of work. Thank you.
Yes, it was. The requirements for a land lease are very specific. They're set in Chapter 30B, Section 12, maybe not. But they're very specific. We had to go through an RFP process, which not only established criteria for each company making a proposal, but also weighted the actual financial benefit to the town. We received two responses, one from Eversource and one from a company called US Wireless Incorporated. I have both proposals if you care to look at the details of either. Both came in and met the basic requirements, so they were both accepted on January 29. And I went through each proposal and assessed each proposal based on the criteria that we published. That's what this three-page summary is. I'll direct you to the last page, which basically indicates their relative scores. For a couple of reasons, Eversource did come up higher on the relative score because they provided more complete financial information to start with, and they demonstrated greater capability to not just build a tower, but to operate a tower. Western Mass Electric, Eversource operates 45 towers similar in construction to the one that's up on the Pecumtuck Ridge throughout Massachusetts, and they have for years. They have a team of engineers on staff to continually assess the condition of the towers and to test them every year. They undergo a facilities assessment to assess their condition. US Wireless is a company that's built some towers over the past 7 or 8 years, but they don't operate them. They build them essentially on a contract basis and then hand them over to another agency or company to operate.
Plus, they were talking about replacing them, and that's terrible.
Correct. In both cases, both of these proponents actually talked about replacing the existing tower. Eversource's expectation is that they're going to replace the tower with one that's exactly the same footprint, the same height, just a little more durable and able to have more antennas mounted on it. The tower that U.S. Wireless is expecting to build is what's called a monopole tower, a single stalk of a tower instead of a lattice-type tower, and an additional 30 feet high, which would probably not get past the special permit stage because it's an expansion of a non-conforming use. That aside, that wasn't weighted in the criteria. Eversource came in with a score of the evaluative criteria of 13, U.S. Wireless with a score of 8, and Eversource came in with a higher expected annual income for the town of $46,000 in year one, whereas U.S. Wireless came in with $40,000 in year one. Because of those two reasons, I'm recommending that the Board of Selectmen award this contract to Eversource, Western Mass Electric Company Eversource, being the most responsible, responsive, and most advantageous proposal to the town.
I make that recommendation. I make a motion to recommend that.
I'll second the motion to accept Doug's recommendation. Any further discussion?
No, this is very complete. Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We already did the permits, discovery, and afterworks. Just a couple of other quick announcements. A reminder or a reiteration, I did apply for a grant through the Community Compact Program for IT services. That grant amount that is requested is $55,000. The grant program itself is for rebuilding IT infrastructure for towns and municipalities, and I proposed that expense to allow us to rebuild the infrastructure here and at the senior center and to create a link between the two, a hard link between the two. What I think this will do is not only improve the quality and performance of our network connections here in Town Hall so we can move data faster, get information to each other faster, but by tying the senior center into it, we can actually do our off-site data backup to the senior center instead of up to the cloud. That alone will save us $300 a month. It'll also enable us, if we have more solid infrastructure, it'll enable us to host our own website. That will save $4,800 a year. I'm sorry, not quite that much, $3,000 a year. To host our own website on a little computer that we just put in the closet in there and off it goes. And the town will save that money in costs for management of the or hosting of the website. So if we get that grant, it might be a really good thing for the town.
Beautiful.
It's a shot in the dark, but we'll see what happens. Speaking of community compact, we were approved. You've got a blank copy here. This is a draft copy submitted to me by the governor's office, but the DLS, Division of Local Services.
Yeah.
There's a signing ceremony tomorrow at 3:15 in the council chambers at the Northampton City Hall. And I spoke with Carolyn earlier. So I will be going down there to join other towns and cities to sign this on behalf of the town. It's ceremonial, but there it is.
Very good.
I'm also going to be going to the Small Town Administrators program that's happening tomorrow in Hadley. Starts at about 11:30. It's a luncheon. I think it's quarterly. Starts about 11:30. It'll go to about 2. So I'll be attending that.
Good.
Cavorting with other administrators and learning what I can from the presentations and programs that are happening there. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that really needs to come before you guys tonight. And I can't think of anything. There's the rest of it is probably just announcements, so I'll just get those to you via email.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Doug, I appreciate everything you're doing. How are you doing getting help?
Thank you for mentioning that. I did actually post for a position for a temporary part-time administrative clerk. The posting made it very clear that the position was only through June 30th, but could be extended more if budgets allow, if you know authorization is there. That went into the recorder a week ago tomorrow, and it'll be listed again tomorrow. I've already spoken with a couple folks in Town Hall to see if they would assist me in reviewing applications and setting up interviews. My hope is to be able to have somebody on board as quickly as possible. I'm going to try to start interviews the beginning of next week and get somebody on board by, as soon as possible.
Good.
We need the help.
I know. I don't want you to go crazy.
Yep.
So up and coming meetings, we're going to add the March 5th date to it. And we have one on the 24th of February, the 10th of March, and the 24th of March.
Yep.
How is that possible?
March 10th and March 24th are both warrant Wednesdays.
They can't have... If February 24th is a Wednesday, the 24th of March can't be a Wednesday.
Is this a leap year?
Yes, it is.
Ah! Then it's going to be March 9 and March 23rd.
If you say so. All I know is they can't be the same. I don't know which one's wrong.
Checking. March 9 and March 23rd. Very good. Which also means that the Friday before is going to be March 4th and not March 5th.
Very good.
So with your permission, I will go back and in the record, I will amend that you will be closing the warrant on March 4th.
Yep. So moved, right? Yes.
Okay. March 4.
Yeah, this year is a leap year.
Yep.
Okay. We've already
done
the award of the tower lease.
Did you do this? Okay. Okay. Any other business come before the board that has not been... In the last 48 hours, it deems to come before us?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, there is one more thing. I'd like your permission to contract with Randy Iser of Harold Eaton Associates to put together a map for, I'm trying to think of the name of the lot. Last year, town meeting awarded the Board of Selectmen authorization to dispose of certain properties owned by the town. One piece... was a piece of land off of Stillwater Road that basically is like a pork chop shape piece of land. It's between Stillwater Road and, is it called, Sand Gully Road, I believe is the name of it. And it forms basically a piece that's the back end of the transfer station, the landfill.
Right.
Now, as soon as we realized that the landfill actually went onto that piece of property, we realized we didn't necessarily want to dispose of it or sell it or get rid of it because we'd lose capability at the transfer station. But with your permission, I'd like to actually get Randy Iser to put together an A&R for that property to basically split off two smaller lots on the northmost side, one which will go off onto Stillwater Road and one which will go off onto Sand Gully Road, both of which I've already confirmed with the building commissioner would be legal building lots, and which the town could then sell without losing the greater capability of the lot for the transfer station.
That's fine. Do you want a formal vote?
I don't need a formal vote. As long as you guys are okay with it, I'll make sure the plan comes to you before it goes anywhere else.
That's good.
And as long as the cost for putting the plan together isn't, you know, through the roof or anything like that.
Mm. Very good.
But it means instead of one building lot, we can actually sell off three off of Stillwater Road, off that area. So
yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, that's it for now.
Anything that will generate free cash?
Cash is good.
You're talking really good about people saving us money, and you sit
Mark,
up here
I
in front
that.
Of them going, I know.
I did
you
that.
I should see the smile on your face.
Well, it's,
did that to bug you?
That's actually something that I don't remember who brought it up. Was it you who brought it up? Where you hate the term free cash?
I know.
Okay.
I know.
Term free cash.
Mark free cash is too, unexpended so that's why I said free
money.
Cash.
Yeah, exactly.
Not free. Somebody's paid for it
at the
several
same time,
times over.
There is no
in this
free.
Case, if we're selling real estate that the town owns, is not using, and won't use, and we're able to generate revenue from it, that is, in fact, that can be easily termed free cash or new revenue.
It's new revenue because
it's new revenue.
I only said free cash
because it's bugging
property, real
I know.
Property,
right?
Which you may have needed in the future. You know the things that Deerfield's not planned really well for is like where to put your fire department, your police department, where to put a pump storage facility. You know, we start expanding the sewer system. Where do you put this stuff?
Sure.
And we don't. Think about those things, and we let things go for peanuts and then go, uh-oh, why do we do that? So we really need to make sure our departments are thinking, you know, what are we doing in the future? Because if we got to buy property later on, I mean, my biggest angst was the fact that we had a chance to buy property beside the wastewater treatment facility down there for peanuts. And we turned it down. And then two, we let it go into A&R, so
now you can never get it again.
We never can get to it.
Yeah, APR.
APR. I have trouble with alphabet soup tonight. I don't know why, but boy, it's killing me. So
well, I make a motion we adjourn.
With the signing of the warrant?
Yes.
Second that motion. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So I got to get another pen because there's too much...